Professor Stephen Hawking was the most popular physicist and greatest mind of our time. He did pioneering work in cosmology, revealing fundamental mysteries of the early universe. Though many of us may not know him personally, but through his papers and popular books, it is fair to say that he has inspired many of us to take up science and physics in particular. Recently, the scientific community suffered a great loss with his demise. Today, we dedicate this video as a tribute to Professor Hawking. To know more about his work and his personal life, we have come to the Department of High Energy Physics here at IISc to talk with Professor Aninda Sinha. Professor Aninda Sinha was a graduate student at the University of Cambridge, where Professor Hawking at the time was a faculty. Professor Sinha is the recipient of the prestigious Swarna Jayanti Fellowship and the 2016 ICTP Prize, among many other awards. Hi, Professor Aninda Sinha. Thank you for talking to us. Sir, your work is related to what Professor Stephen Hawking also worked on, but you know him on a personal level. Would you please tell us about that?
Yeah, first of all, I'm very happy to be talking to you. I was a graduate student in Cambridge from 2001 to 2004, and before that I was also a master's student in Cambridge. And so, as a graduate student, I was in the Department of Applied Mathematics and Theoretical Physics. And Stephen Hawking was also associated with the Department of Applied Mathematics and Theoretical Physics. It's called DAMP for short. When I was a fellow, then my office was on the same floor as Hawking's. So I used to see him come into work, come in for seminars.
Do you recall any particular incident?
Yeah, there are a few. One particular incident, which was when I was a graduate student, Stephen used to come in for these Friday general relativity lunchtime seminars. So Cambridge had this tradition at that point of time that we would have a pizza lunch on Fridays, and various faculty members, postdocs, students would come there primarily to eat pizza, and then Stephen used to come to listen to some interesting talk, whatever caught his fancy. Of course, he did not have pizza. His nurses fed him. He had his own food. He was very fond of Indian curries. In one of these seminars, all of us had virtually dozed off because our stomachs were full. But I noticed that Hawking was furiously trying to compose a sentence. And it used to take him a long time to compose sentences because at that point of time he could still, he had some movement in his fingers, which he gradually lost over the time as well. But it took him a lot of time to compose a sentence on a voice synthesizer. So, and by the time he finished composing his sentence, it was a question. It was almost towards the end of the seminar. And his question was about the sign of a Casimir energy in one of the very first few slides. And only he had noticed that this person was using the wrong sign. And I don't remember the exact details, but from his comment, it seemed like his entire seminar, whatever followed, his conclusions were erroneous because of this wrong sign. And it's quite remarkable that he had actually noticed that mistake.
Please tell us about his most important contribution.
Yeah, so in his own words, his most important contribution was to discover the fact that these objects called black holes are not black because they emit radiation. So black hole is a region of space-time where gravity is so strong that it does not let light escape. That's why, because light does not escape, that's why it appears black. And for a long time it was not realized that there was this intimate connection between quantum mechanics and black holes. In the 1970s, people were making these, in some sense, heuristic observations that you could associate an entropy with a black hole, and this entropy, which was related to the area of this, the event horizon of the black hole, satisfied various properties which entropy would satisfy. For example, it would describe the second law of thermodynamics. But Hawking actually discovered that there would be a process which eventually goes by the name of Hawking radiation, by which a black hole would evaporate. And this would be a real radiation. If you sat down with a bolometer or something to detect radiation very far away, you would actually see this radiation. So this was his most important discovery, and it was important for several reasons. The most important reason is that when you try to write down a formula for entropy and the temperature of this black hole, you encounter fundamental constants like Planck's constant, Newton's constant, and you also encounter the Boltzmann constant. So it's as if you are unifying all these three together in a beautiful formula. So you require, this formula actually knows about these three. And it was in a very precise way that for the first time one could talk about quantum mechanics, gravity, and statistical mechanics in the same breath. And this opened up a lot of important directions in the future.
Did he have difficulties in making his fellow scientists believe in his theories? Like, did he ever have doubts on his, say, own conclusions?
So as far as I know, and this is based on an interview that Hawking gave a long time back, that his Hawking evaporation theory, the fact that black holes would radiate, wasn't immediately accepted. So when he first presented the seminar, it wasn't immediately accepted. So this is typically how theoretical physics works, and in fact, how science works. So you postulate something, there is a debate, scientists get together and they try to find flaws or try to find the merits of that theory and then try to take it forward. So I'm sure he had difficulties in convincing other people of his theories. Whether he himself had doubts, I'm not entirely sure, because theorists have a tendency of being very stubborn people. Typically good theorists are very difficult to sway, so they stick to their stance.
Sir, finally, how does Professor Hawking measure as a scientist? Like, if we do not consider his handicap?
That's an important but a somewhat delicate question. His popularity, so the fact that actually he featured in so many public events, or for that matter of fact, the fact that he featured in The Simpsons, or he was frequently referred to as the smartest man alive. He featured in this telecom series called The Big Bang Theory. I'm sure that these had to do with his handicap. But if you leave that aside, even if you leave his handicap aside, if you measure his work, the kind of contributions that he's made, the examples that I gave, where actually his work made various different scientists talk to each other, physicists, mathematicians, his work spurned this debate about quantum mechanics and gravity, his work spun our imagination about how the universe began, where it is heading. If you just focus on the scientific contributions, it is, I think, more than enough to last at least a lifetime, if not several lifetimes. And so, in a word, his contribution has been stellar as a scientist. His contribution as a mentor of PhD students also has been stellar, because he mentored several PhD students, many of whom have permanent positions now, many of whom actually landed up making seminal and important contributions right from the time that they were graduate students. And this speaks volumes of his capability as a mentor, in spite of his severe handicap. And so I think in one word, his contributions as a physicist, as a human being, have been outstanding and inspire several generations. Thank you.